Well, it's Horace Memorial Symposium, and I will not talk about his scientific contribution in the world. Talks already were said about his force, his mass, his energy. Well, since it's his day, I will say a few things about calling my life, which are not quite scientific. One was the my doctoral thesis was accepted here. Then it was by tiny margin, as far as I heard, by the one vote, and this was then by Collis and Yeh. Another thing was in communication with him, it was last spring. Somehow, he really was a person who knew everything about superconductivity. A year ago, I was teaching basic superconductivity course for undergraduate. And there was a lecture about Pippard non-local response. And that's somehow now completely forgotten, because all useful superconductors are type 2, and what people do, who cares? But if you take BCS paper, then more than half of it was deriving Pippard non-local electrodynamics. And I'm teaching for undergraduates, so I cannot do it, so I just look in the textbook, and then what one's supposed to do is that usually J is proportional to vector potential, and they are at the same point, and that's local London electrodynamics. Now, non-local, we should put here x, here should put integral, and here there's kernel, which has correlation length inside. And if we solve this integral equation, we can estimate, assuming that penetration depth, which would appear if so psi 0 is much larger than London penetration depth, then we can balance term and we obtain that lambda is about London square psi 0 in the power 1 over 3. So that's Pippard result. That's in the textbook. Then also in the textbook it said that if one goes from clean to dirty, then psi 0 should be replaced in correlator by mean free path. And that's it. Good. So I replace psi 0 here by mean free path, and I obtain such a puzzling result that penetration depth becomes smaller when I make my superconductors more dirty, which sounds a bit weird. Of course, eventually we'll go to local electrodynamics where there will be another formula, but here it's very non-local, so how can it be? Unfortunately, in the textbooks, there is long derivation of BCS, which you cannot present to students for clean case and nothing about dirty apart from this remark, so how can one reconcile it? So I start to run around ACH asking experts, and we'll have quite a few. Well, Morris Rice was one of them, then we also have Lev Boloyevsky visiting us, and no answer. Yes, well, I don't remember. Who cares? So, then I sent to Kolya email and got an answer. Well, was one line. It is this paragraph of Degen, And I read it before, and well, I thought there's nothing about that or something. So it's what it says, I just looked more carefully, read them. Yeah, it was answer to all my questions. So, well, rather trivial question, but now you get impressed by comparison, because I thought, well, other experts nearby, and they are no experts, they know, they should know the answer, it's basics, but it appears no, and he knew, and others didn't. So unfortunately, there are less and less people than one can ask such a simple question and get an answer. So the topic of my talk is about structural transition of two-dimensional lattice on a substrate, and loosely speaking, I call it squaring the triangle. There was an old problem in ancient time about squaring the circle in math, how to fit square to circle, and now we'll try to fit square to triangle. So we take particles in two dimension, and usually particles in two dimension, if they want to form lattice, then for almost any interaction, they would like to form triangle lattice. That's kind of lowest energy state. But now we put these particles on a substrate in external potential, which wants to make a square lattice. And if potential is very strong, the lattice would be square. If potential is absent, it is triangle. And the question is how we go from square to triangle. And, well, that's phase diagram. It appears to be quite many different regimes, which I will try to sketch during the talk. So we go from square at large potential to some kind of zigzag structure, and then there are two transitions with different soliton lattices, and here eventually we get to this trend. So that's not about vortices, it's other particles, but again, since it's Collins days, one should say that there was very interesting work by Ivlev, Kopnin, and Pokrovsky on vortices. They consider the following situation: we have strongly layered superconductor and put magnetic field along the layers. And we have situation where intrinsic pinning by layer structure is so strong that vortices cannot move across the layers. And now we change the field so vortices can go only along the layers, and what would be corresponding lattices. So they kind of try, if potential is not only like this, but like this, then it would be our problem. They consider more simple version of it, and it also happened to be quite complicated. So that's variation. And we will see that there are some similarity of what they have here as well. So that's the list of co-authors, quite a big one, and I think actually the main player is Sergei Korshunov, so he should actually present this talk here. Well, the first author is Barbara Tyler, a student in our group, and well, when I learned that this problem was given to a student, I was kind of extremely, well, how to say, excited, because this is a classic example of a problem which should never be given to a student. Because in 1D, one-dimensional version is conventional to conventional transition, so it goes back to almost 100 years ago to Franke and Kontorova, and one has well, possible serotonic structure, dental staircase, and so on. So that's known and well studied and quite complicated problem in 1D. Now, do you believe that in 2D it would be easier? Or do you believe that nobody thought about this in 2D? That would be a bit naive because, well, particles on substrate, that's something which was studied at 70s and 80s, so there are this Nobel guesses on graphite. And so two-dimensional version was also studied. Well, we are not expert, so to give a problem which is definitely complicated and was looked at to a student is really to kill her or him, because everything which was easy was already done, and what is not easy is too difficult to a student. And since we ourselves are not experts, we even cannot say which is easy and which was done. So then actually what we had all the time, for a substantial amount of time, was that we are trying to understand something, and eventually we understood and say, oh great, that's really interesting results that we obtained, just to know, to learn that 80 years ago Novak and Matej published paper on that. Then we worked harder and harder and harder and got another interesting result, which we think that it's new, and then we know that Pokrovsky et al. In 1980 obtained that. So eventually we believe that we obtained something that in general case, I would say, still will be on the level of little improvement of what others did, but we believe that we have original results. But since we are not experts, if you tell us that, yeah, that was actually published 25 years ago by this and that, I would be happy to know. So it's fashionable to study cold atoms and molecules nowadays. So there are dipolar molecules, and these dipolar molecules can be polarized by electric fields, and they have dipoles, and these dipoles interact like dipole interacts. Then we put them on optical lattice, because that's what they are doing, and then we have this novel problem for cold atoms, so dipole molecules on optical lattice, and now we want to study.
What about the third coordinate? Are they trapped?
Yes, you can trap. Mm-hmm. Well, again, that's how we may try to sell it for them. Eventually, we are not really expert in this cold atom stuff, and actually, our attempt to sell it to them failed in the first round because they have other ideas.
D squared part, the second round.
Sorry?
D squared, I think.
Well, we call it D, so D is the product of dipole moments.
So of dipole moments?
No, D is the product of dipole moments.
Square of dipole moments.
Well, yeah, square of dipole moments. Yeah, square of dipole moments. Well, yeah, there is this D is D1 times D2. Well, the D1 and D2 are equal. Now, I should say that this dipole interaction is, in some sense, quite general, because if you put, let's say, in this old time, in 70s, 80s, when they put Nobel guesses on the surface of some material, then usually surface, well, is either electron positive or electron negative, so there is breaking of symmetry, and actually the surface attracts or repels electron away from the nuclear, so then this molecule, the atoms, neutral atoms, if you put it close to the surface, it becomes polarized along the normal in one or another direction, and since dipole interaction fails slower than van der Waals, then actually even for this old problem of adsorbed atoms, they consider the same dipole-dipole interactions, so no times also. But of course, in a Morrison study, people were doing structured superconductors where one can put vortices and then there will be another. So our version is this, and I will try not really go in details of this interaction, but results are pretty sensitive to interactions. So I'll try to do as much as elasticity theory, but it appears that it matters what kind of interaction it is. So the difference in energy between square and triangular lattice is rather small, so if we measure energy in the dipole interaction between two neighbors, then the difference in is about few percent of the total energy, so they are very close together in energy, so the scales would be
so do
much.
Do you believe that the distance between the neighbors is fixed? Or what, since actually you're...
Okay, you mean without potential?
Yes, without potential.
Yeah.
What does it mean? The
without potential, without potential, we need to add pressure because they repel each other and will fall away, so we add pressure and then the density depends on the pressure, and in general one can consider different pressure. Well, the problem appears to be complicated in the simple version, so we make pressure such that the density of particles is without potential is equal to the density of minimum that they fit. Now, of course, if we change pressure, that would be another case, but that's what we do. Now, in PowerPoint, there is option to draw pictures with numbers. So that's, I try to do my best to draw square and triangle with the same density. So A is the side of the triangle, B is the side of square. You see they are, the difference is tiny, it's about 7%. Then actually one thing, what should be commensurate with what, is actually not the side with the side, but it's the height of a triangle with the side, because if you put this arrow in this minima and this point in this minima, they are already commensurate, at least for one harmonics of this square potential. So this gives our incommensurability parameter, which is how much the height of triangle is different from the side of square. Funny enough, for this pressure, this incommensurability parameter is the same as just A over B minus 1. So, well, it's just divided square root 3 by 2 and you get the same ratio. But what is commensurate is not side with side, because then this will be in the middle, but height with the side. So that's about pressure, and now we want to study as a function of substrate potential what are different phases. There are three commensurate, well, three simple structures which are important, just square lattice, that would be good for high potential, hexagonal lattice, this would be good for zero potential, and if we just take undeformed square lattice, put on the substrate and look what is the typical energy, then since average value of so V is coefficient in front of cosine, and since in front of 1 minus cosine, since average value of cosine is 0, then we have linear increase in energy. Then we have another important commensurate structure where we fit this triangle to one mode and forget about another. So this corresponds to isosceles lattice, so this triangle is not really symmetric, it has side B and the height B. So that's all rhombic phase. And this phase is commensurate with one, there are two modes for square lattice, is commensurate with one mode, and from another it has a slope which is 1/2. So here is the slope V, here is the slope 1/2, and here we forget about relaxation to the substrate. Now we start from the square and we lower and we look what actually happened. And what happens is square lattice without potential is unstable. That it corresponds to a local maxima and not minima, but substrate stabilizes it. But when you reduce the substrate, then the tendency to have a shift will overcome, and eventually instability will appear at some critical value of potential. This one can really look in the Fourier what is the most unstable mode and find it, and it will happen at 0.2. One can do...
Is this continuous transition?
Yep. Second prototype transition with actually like square root behavior. So one can do simple exercise. So we try to shift this row with respect to each other, and we introduce center of mass coordinate and in cell distortion, that's how they go, and minimize energy with two of them. So this is substrate potential, just sum of two cosines can be written as the product of two cosines. And we add the energy of interaction between different rows in the simple form as cosine of displacement, such that for square it's maximum, for triangle it's minimum. Actually, you can calculate this interaction between rows, just taking lattice sum and using Poisson ratio, and then it appears that from the nearest rows it's really cosine potential, and from the next one it's exponentially suppressed. So this cosine is what you really obtain, and then we get a critical value where it's favorable to go away from the square lattice, and the difference from exact is about 1%. Exact was 0.201. Well, exact means numerically minimizing lattice deformation. That's one thing, and it goes here like a square root. Eventually, with it, and another thing, what we obtain that as a function of sigma center of mass, that if we move along this zigzag distortion, then effective potential has this form, so it's cosine square, which means that the period is half of the original period. And another important thing is that this potential is in square. Period?
Double.
Half. Cosine square, you write it as cosine 2 q sigma, and sigma would be 1/2. And one can kind of for when this lattice is almost triangle, then one can understand them. That's minimize here the maximum, so if this is this potential, then it's better to put particles to the maximal force, and then they will, because then the force will be maximal and then will be mostly relaxed. So that's one state. Now if you shift from here to here, then it's half a period. So from here to here will be full period, but from here to here it's half. So that's
symmetrical.
And another important thing is that the coefficient from that is V square. So when V is small, this motion of center of mass along the zigzag has small potential. That would be very important. So what we have then is this zigzag phase. Now the zigzag break a symmetry, so it have period double phase, and there are four possible kinds of zigzag. One trivial, which replacing delta by minus delta, because you can deform this way or that one, and another rotated by 90 degrees. So there are different possible structure, and when we reduce potential, then this structure goes to the zigzag, become deformation becomes equal to half a period, and we go to this isosceles lattice where this is B and this is B. So that's actually what I showed from Ilya Konstantin Pokrovsky. That's the state where they started. They didn't have this additional harmonic, that's why they got it immediately, and we are going there only in the limit of low potential if we continue this branch.
Sorry, Dima, maybe I can
yes.
You consider this curve at fixed concentration.
At fixed pressure.
Fixed pressure, oh, I see. And if you would consider the problem at fixed concentration, what you will obtain?
For this curve, actually doesn't matter, because when we go along this curve, concentration is not changed. It's a commensurate phase, just you have
this is commensurate with the triangle.
No, no, it's it's well, you just shift the row, but this distance is unchanged, so this distance is still period. So then the density doesn't change from this shift. Later it would be important, and the density would be different. But for on this curve, density is not changed.
Is this transition also continuous?
Well. You mean here it's continuous.
And there?
Well, here we go to zero potential. Now, you see, that's interesting. That potential is zero, but the lattice is not hexagonal. The lattice is this triangle, which is isosceles, so two sides are equal, but the base is not equal to these two sides, it's equal to the height. So you have zero potential, but the lattice is not the one which you actually would like to have. But if you relax only along one direction, then that's what happens. Now what you should do is relax along other direction, and then you can do perturbation theory. So this was attempt from large potential, this was attempt from small potential. Here you just push hexagonal lattice in the weak potential to perturbation theory, and look how lattice will get distorted. since this, for this density, this triangular lattice is incommensurate with square, then on average, displacing the energy would not change because it's incommensurate, but you can rotate and look how the energy changed. And then it appears that the minimum of energy corresponds to little misorientation where triangle is rotated with respect to square by something little than 4 degrees. And this was our first great surprise that we worked hard to understand and later found that Novak and McTighe did it 30 years before us. So now instead of this trivial geometry we have this complicated geometry, and here some colloids look like they cross each other so that there will be first transition, and that's more or less when Sergei joined us, and he told that no, it would not be first transition, there would be solitons, so we started to study solitons, and there was a very important paper by Bobrovsky Tolopov about solitons that actually, I knew about this, but more that that's a phase where they map thermodynamics of solitons to Fermi gas, and so there was this static repulsion analogy, so I knew this part of the story, but that they really look on two-dimensional arrangement, this kind of didn't, I miss it. So, and they introduce so-called resonance approximation, and the physics is the following. This is wave vector of the substrate. Now, lattice, particle lattice is periodic. So the relevant wave vector which particle would feel would be the difference between the substrate wave vector and inverse, and the wave vector of the inverse lattice. Now, when we, so this would be this P, that's the wave component of potential particles would feel. Now, that's elastic energy, which is P square U square, and then the substrate. So now it's P, which is different. And now we will rotate two lattices, and then P would change. Now, the deformation is bigger for the smallest P, because it's 1 over P square, and so the contribution to energy, substrate will minimize energy, would be biggest for the smallest P, so the system would like to rotate such that to make this P small, so we rotate actually let fixed crystal lattice and rotate substrate. Then there are two modes, and we can make only one close to K, and another we throw away because it's less important because of this 1 over P square. And that's the way how one go from two modes to one. That's what Pokrovsky and Tolopov invent, and that's resonance approximation. Now, if we have this simple elasticity, then the best way would be to make K a long P, because that's the smallest P. Now, our lattice is strongly incompressible, so for this geometry, compression modulus is 10 times bigger than shear, and if it was here the smallest P, and then they have zero angle between each other, then the deformation would be due to compression. But if we rotate it away, we'll get profit because shear is small. And for strongly incompressible situation, this angle between P and Q is 45 degrees, and then this angle between triangle and square would be this 4 degrees, which is incommensurability parameter. So, in general situation that Pokrovsky Tolopov, we would have sets of solitons which run with a tangent of angle equal to square root of Poisson ratio. So kappa mu are compression and shear, and we'll have continuous transition with appearance of these two-dimensional arrays of solitons. So for our it's about 40, well, close to 45 degrees, 42 point something degrees. So that's the picture which we have. If we do the Reznov approximation, so we threw away one harmonics of the substrate. So now what we do in some sense is this Ivlev-Kapnin-Pokrovsky problem, but where pinning potential gets weaker. So we don't have motion like this, but motion away. And then we'll have phase transition from here it's hexagonal lattice, here it is isosceles lattice. So this lattice of this triangle, and this isosceles lattice continuously, which is commensurate with this one moment, becomes incommensurate due to appearance of sequence of solitons. So that's it.
In this way, you insist that the phase, intermediate phase is laminar. Actually, usually this crossed balls, and then the phase is in the first order. It's known that this resonance theory, what you call the solitons, it gives second order phase transitions. And usually, it's the major system in the first order, it's not laminar.
It's just
the nodes of interference, intersection between these different lines.
It depends whether they give
first order transitions.
Well, it depends whether the energy of intersection is positive or negative, and then what kind of people was studying in the 80s was also thermal effects, so a lot of them. Willem, so he considered hexagonal.
But since you have some models behind, yeah. Some microscopic models, so do you know indeed that this is laminar, not interference?
No,
more favorable.
We don't.
So, Dima, that means for fluctuations.
Yes, no fluctuations.
No fluctuations.
So then two minutes. but here we went not to square that scalar. Here we went to isosceles lattice. Now we should go to square, and that's what we believe was not done by others. So then we have actually number of different solitons, and topologically speaking, they're not only solitons, but domain walls, because we have different zigzags. So soliton we call something where after we go through soliton, we come to the same minima, maybe shifted by period. And domain wall we call something where on two sides we have different structure, which are different by symmetry. And they have different indices, so that's plotted and so on. We should study all this energy. This would be something which resembles Pokrovsky-Talapov soliton, but now we should look how it is changed due to appearance of another harmonics. And here important thing is that potential for the motion along this is large, but potential for the motion on this is small, and we try to think perturbatively, and we look and study and study and study. And eventually it appears that we don't trust our result that much, because even I show that the square and triangle were pretty much close, but unharmonicity is still large and can change the solitons by, we have to choose which one has lower energy, and they have like 30% different energy. One is big, one is more favorable. Now, if we start from hexagonal lattice, we get one result. If we start from isosceles, we get 40%, and then we change which one is bigger. And inside the soliton lattice is more like hexagonal, and the way it's more like that. So eventually, we have to rely on numerics, just put some variational position of solitons and then minimize energy and look how it relaxes, which appears also not quite trivial task. And then what we obtain is that the soliton that has highest energy, which means that it will appear first, is that's what we call horizontal soliton, and that's actually not a soliton, but the main wall, which actually propagation of the soliton will kill the second harmonics. So Pokrovsky Telapov just dropped the second harmonics because effect is small. We take it into account, and then we have solitons which propagate and destroy it. And they appear, that's our scenario. Quite unexpectedly, it appears that this, well, call it horizontal because potential is like this and soliton is horizontal like that, so we call it horizontal. But it appears that if we optimize with the angle, if we do analytic, then the minima is really horizontal. But when we do numeric, it appears that it actually has angle the best which we found. Again, numerically, you cannot change continuously. You should put soliton along some commensurate direction. Then it appears that 45 degrees would be the best soliton, which kind of was surprising because usually what we read in the books was that, you know, if you have square lattice or rectangle lattice, then soliton runs along the symmetry direction of the lattice. Here it appears that the best soliton, well, that is, we show that the better soliton runs not along the symmetry axis. Maybe eventually it will be not 45 degrees, but 47.5 or something, but those which runs on 45 has slightly higher energy and slightly more favorable than this one. So that's my last slide. So the picture that we have is that when we lower the temperature, we go from the square lattice to this zigzag structure. When we lower potential further, then this zigzag is increased, and the effective potential to move along here is decreased. Then at some value of potential, which we calculated, we have transition to solitonic lattice of this, well, loosely speaking, horizontal, which are not actually horizontal. Then when they propagate, they remove the second modes effectively, and lattice becomes isosceles. And here we go to Pokrovsky Telapov solitons and come here. So that's the final picture that
we obtained. Okay, let us think this way. So, question, remarks, comments?
But then you have to go to a really triangle.
When this solitron propagates, when there are more and more.
To go down.
Yes. You mean that this should be.
Yes.
I should check what is this number. This supposed to be, because hexagonal lattice also has some energy. So zero energy should be, zero effective should be here. And then here it is a triangle. Now where the zero energy is, where the pure hexagonal is at 11.09 or something else, I mean
that if you forget about the history,
yeah. Here it is hexagonal.
Down.
Well, here the lattice is hexagonal.
Yes.
And it is hexagonal. There is some remembrance of original square that it is hexagonal, which is rotated by the three point some degrees with respect to square, but then it's perfect hexagonal lattice. And here the offset, well, one should not pay attention.
So, are fluctuations in the list of future verbs?
Well, you see, that's precisely what this called people are talking, because they, in their dreams, they want to study quantum fluctuation, thermal fluctuation, how this effect. Now, for us, in order to study fluctuation, it's good first to understand what happens in the absence.
This and, this and
so, and you know, there's very little one can do about fluctuation apart from some kind of Lindemann something. So, I would say, if it's about generalization of that, then
so there are some continuous transitions.
Oh, you mean like there?
Yes.
Yeah. There is an aesthetic problem. You don't investigate the collective modes of this crystal.
Well, what we did was just to find minimum of energy. Even not looking, for example, here when the soliton disappears here or here, it is not. So here there is no hysteresis. If we just go up and down, that's perfectly smooth. Here, when soliton appears, it is similar to let's say HC1. In superconductors, where minimal energy is when water is on, but if you just apply the field and cross HC1, then we know water don't go because the surface there, Meissner state is still stable, it just has higher energies, so there is this effect as well. Now, one could probe, and that's probably more towards your question, because how can we probe all the structure? Because when there's still, we cannot really see the structure with the eye, but if we try to shake letters, then all the structure from here, they are anisotropic. So then, with respect to square, so this way, it's anisotropic. So if we shake like that or like that, the response would be different. And that's the way to probe. That's, for us, this looks like one of the promising ways really to measure this transition by the difference in dynamic response. But this will
at V not equal zero at this point, the problem becomes quite similar to the linear crystal problem in most structures when you have electron sheet and then due to image forces you have dipole-dipole interaction.
Yes.
And this is very well known problem investigated by elastic like scattering, for example. So it would be interesting to see what gives substrate potential its influence on the collective modes of this system.
As I try to say, like one-dimensional version of this problem is already quite interesting and complicated. And two-dimensional, there's a lot of things one can try to do. So try to do something very first, and you can ask question: what about this and what about this? Almost in every step. So there are like and. The problem just for two-dimensional letters, well, we will study for is electron like melting, quantum melting, of and so on and so forth. Now here we try to look commensurate and commensurate in 2D, and even this is seems to be
intuitive. Okay, let us end this speaker again.